sermon today. I talked to Tom Norwalk, the association minister, and just told him, you know, that because of the snow, our congregational meeting got canceled. So it was going to be out of 10, so I was going to have to rush home. He said, no, I'll go up to where you were going to go. He said, because I really don't think you can let them have their congregational meeting on chaperone. So I don't know what Tom knows that I don't, but he also mentioned something about, is that guy Chip still at the church? So,
you know, I talked to Tom, and he said, on the side, he said, I should yell at him what they passed.
Is that what it was? So I'm thrilled to have Amy here leading us in worship by sharing the word. I just have a couple of announcements to bring to your attention. First, the aforementioned congregational meeting will be right after church is over. So if you are a member of the church, we hope you will stay. We had to postpone it because of the bad weather that we had. We didn't get the 50 people needed for a quorum. So go ahead, just stand up, mill around, say hi and everything, but stick around so we can get everybody seated and get the meeting going. That's all I have by way of announcements. Is there anything else that needs to be brought up for the good of the congregation? Ms. Brennan.
Our annual bowling party is the 24th, February 24th, 1 to 3 at Frankfurt Bowl. It's $10 a person, and you can come see me between the service and the meeting. I'll be right here.
Thank you. Anything else? Well, seeing nothing then, from fishing fleets and busy harbors, God gathers simple sailors. Through persecution and injustice, God calls brave prophets. When we least expect it, Christ gathers us in and calls us to follow him. Let us gather and answer Christ's call.
Thank you.
join me responsibly in our call to worship. Called by God, we have come to worship.
Called by Christ, we have come to follow.
Called by the Spirit, we have come to rejoice.
All together, we will listen and pray.
I would invite all that are able now to please stand as we join together in the hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Thank you.
our service of worship where we have the opportunity to lift up and to share with each other the concerns and joys of our lives. So at this time, I would invite any that are so led to lift up any concerns or joys that you may be having at this time.
I have a joy. We are proud great grandparents of another little boy. He was born Friday to our granddaughter Diane. And also a joy, Shara's back from D.C. and her daughter is with her.
Glad you could be with us. Good to see you again. Lord of your mercy.
Here are our prayers.
All right, Ilsa, what you got for us?
Well, I don't know. It's good and bad, and it's bad and good, whatever you want it. I am so disappointed that we don't have snow, because I want to see how my little old women's carriage takes the snow. I never have driven a small car like this, except in Germany, but the streets are not much smaller there, so that doesn't count. But I feel really almost, I don't know, discouraged to go on the street. I don't know if anybody else can see me. Oh my God.
We're going to start something. You know that, how bad is it? Think everyone else, when anybody else gets up, he's going to say the good news and bad news. And we're going to start with, what's the good news?
Oh, there is no snow yet, so it's easy to find.
Okay, all right. Lord, in your mercy.
Thank you. And then we asked for prayers. My grandmother fell this week, and she's still in the hospital on Thursday.
Okay. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We had a nice duet today, and I have a nice duet every day of my life because of my wife, Mary Linshaw, whose birthday is today.
Well, you know what that means, Mary. Today is Boy Scout Recognition and Appreciation Day. So since he is the one, his brother is sick, so that's why he's not here, and Jacob is up at school, so that's not why he's not here. So he's representing the whole group. So for the members of our church that serve in the Boy Scout, for those around the country that participate in Boy Scouts, both as Scouts and as leaders, our appreciation and love. I would invite us now to bow our heads and be in the time and the spirit. Gracious, loving, and compassionate God, we give you thanks for this glorious morning that greeted us when we awoke from slumber. The privilege that it gave us to be able to gather here in this sacred space among sisters and brothers in Christ to lift hearts and voices and spirits thanks and praise to you. God, we know that we have so much you have blessed us with. We know that we have so much for us to be thankful for. But today, God, I would like to thank you especially for the gift of joy and of life. I give you thanks for a group of people that can gather to do and be a part of the solemnness that is coming before you in worship and praise, and yet that are free enough to be able to enjoy each other, to have fun with each other, to tease each other, to support and lift up and nurture and to celebrate with each other. God, in this world where there is so much pain and hate and dissension, it is wonderful that we have this place to which we may come to truly be joyful, to laugh and share in your presence amongst us and with us. We pray for those that do not have a safe place where they can go, be it a church or a family or anywhere where they can feel like they can just let go, enjoy themselves, celebrate the goodness in their lives with laughter. We pray for the strength and the courage to go out into the world and to share this feeling of exuberance, of joy, of celebration and thanksgiving that is with us when we gather to worship. And we pray that we might, in some small way, be a conduit of your joy, your holy laughter and celebration, inviting those that need such a place to come, know that they will be welcomed, that they will be celebrated, that they can be a part of the joy that is the fellowship of Christ Jesus. Well, Holy One, we lift this prayer up to you this morning as we have shared with you our concerns and our joys, and we bring them all to you when we pray together in one voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressuring in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and talked to the crowds from the boat. When he finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep waters and let your nets down for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long and have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid, for from now on you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to the shore, they left everything and followed him. Hear what the Spirit says to the church.
Tells us that despite it being a slow day to catch fish, Jesus
Jesus instructs the fishermen to put down their nets into the water, and as they do, the nets miraculously pull up tons and tons of fishes, fish of all kinds, and everyone is astonished. Biblical scholars have long interpreted this story in two particular ways. First, as a miracle of abundance. By pulling a multitude of fish from the water, Jesus demonstrates the abundance of God's love. The abundance of love that God has for humanity, a love that is unexpected and surprising, something that comes out of nowhere and is almost too much for us to handle. Second, biblical scholars point to the story's ending, when Jesus calls the disciples forward and says to them, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." Whereupon they left everything that they knew, everything that was familiar, and followed him. And while these two classic interpretations can give us enough theological meat to chew on for millennia, there is another interpretation that I would like to explore with you all this morning. In preparing for today's sermon, I was reminded that the Bible is full of stories about people at sea, people in water. When we think about these stories, we think about Noah and the ark, Jonah and the whale, Moses and the Red Sea, Jesus walking on water and calming the storms. And each, in its own way, is a story of risk and safety. In these stories, the sea often represents danger or chaos and even death, like in the flood. And yet, in each story, God provides a boat or an ark or a whale, and that this space creates a sense of safety. In the story of Moses, the safety is literally created by the space itself when the sea parts and the people are able to pass through. The Bible tells us that time and time again, God creates space for people to find sanctuary and salvation. And that often, the space is found in the metaphor of boats. How fitting, then, that one of Jesus' first miracles takes place on a boat, on the water. For some Christian scholars, the metaphor of a boat means that it protects us from life's trials and storms, and it is representative of the Christian church, of the body of Christ, of the beloved community, as Martin Luther King Jr. calls it. They suggest that the boat Jesus sits in is a symbol for our communities and our congregations, the space here that we sit in this morning. And that, like scooping up from the sea, both provides us with spiritual nourishment and the inspiration to follow Jesus and become his disciples. This past week, I was explaining to Pastor Mark earlier this morning, I celebrated my second year anniversary of becoming ordained, of becoming a minister within the United Church of Christ. And if I were to be perfectly honest with you all, I would say that I never expected to be a minister. I never expected to go to seminary or to preach the Word of God. My parents did not raise me or my sister to go to church. I did not go to Sunday school as a child. In fact, it was not until I was 8 years old when my neighbor, Rebecca Hunt, she was my same age, she told me one Sunday, and I think she was wearing this beautiful dress, she was in her Sunday dress, she told me that there was such a thing as God and that I was a heathen and a pagan. As I admire her Sunday dress, I prefer
The church became the epicenter of my life. I loved it hard, and it loved me hard right back. I attended youth groups and overnight retreats, community service and outreach opportunities. I sang in the youth choir, and I started to work in the church during the weeks, and I attended service every Sunday without fail. That church welcomed me in and provided a space of safety and sanctuary from which I grew, healed, and flourished. The miracle of the Christian church for the last 2,000 years is that people have experienced a story like mine. I would imagine that each one of you has a somewhat similar story of how the church welcomed you in, how you found yourself going to church for the first time, and the reasons that you stayed and kept coming back. And for each story that we have of being welcomed in, there does exist stories of people who are excluded, people who are burned from the church, people who are not welcomed in. In this morning's scripture, we find Jesus demonstrating the potential safety that a relationship with God provides. More than this, we witness the miracle of Jesus catching such a large number of fish that two boats begin to sink under the weight of it. The Gospel of Matthew tells it like this. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. Now, I am visiting you all today from Plainfield Congregational Church. I work there as an associate pastor, and I have been for 2 years, but I do not live in Plainfield. I live in Chicago, on the north side, very close to Evanston. It's a bit of a drive. It's a bit of a drive, but I don't mind it. I listen to a lot of podcasts, and that has kept me sane. But one of the things that I like to do, especially on Sundays, is, you know, I'll drive out early in the morning, and thankfully on Sunday mornings, the drive's pretty quick, and I can drive past the lake as I go, and that's something that always is beautiful to look at. But I go, and I serve at my church, and then I drive back. And I don't know about Pastor Mark, but most pastors that I know, after Sunday morning has ended, they go home and they do one of two or three things. They nap, they binge Netflix, and they nap.
You forgot to eat.
Well, that's part of it. There are definitely some mornings where I prefer to nap as than to eat. But most Sunday afternoons, between my eating and napping, there's something else that I do. There is a church on the north side of Chicago that is a startup church. It's a new church, and I have a friend that is pastoring it. And on Sunday evenings, after I've had a full morning at church, I go back to church. And it's a church that, at the moment, meets in a bar. Meets in a bar. And I'll admit, it's a bit strange attending church in a bar. I may come from a heathen and paganistic background, but even this is a little bit sometimes of a stretch. We can hold a beer while we pass the peace and share our joys and concerns. But there is an abundance of spirits in that church, and I don't just mean the beer. It is a church that takes in all kinds of fish, but mostly it takes in misfits. A church where the fish come in from the sea and that have been cast out from other churches, sometimes thrown back. A church of people who are queers and transgenders, agnostics, and sometimes even atheists. It is a church full of people who don't quite feel comfortable in regular church, people who've been burned or excluded from the mainstream Christianity. Now, if I had to guess, I to feel excluded, to feel left out. At this church that I attend in Chicago, there are definitely days where I feel like the whole congregation is made up of people like this. People who are a little awkward, people who talk too loud and too often, or people who barely talk at all. People who are lonely and needy, who are broken and wounded. People who only know how to love in messy and sometimes uncomfortable ways. People who I might not normally associate with, and yet, by the grace of God, they heard the same message of love and grace and belonging that I did. And like me, they showed up. And now we're all in the same boat. We all got scooped up by the dragnet that God pulled into the water. And even though there are definitely some days I question the logic of God's reasoning to pull these fish along into the boat, Scripture tells us that being Christian and following the ways of Jesus is like being in a boat upon the water. Equal parts safety and salvation, chaos and danger. Today's scripture invites us to question, what are the risks and safeties of being a Christian and leading a spiritual life? What are the risks of welcoming the stranger in, welcoming the refugee, the immigrant? And what are the risks of not welcoming the stranger in? What are the risks of not welcoming the lowly, the broken among us? The scripture invites us to question, how do we live into our discipleship and coexist in the boat together, loving one another, even when the storms of life get bumpy and a bit wild. And like most stories in Scripture, Jesus has the answer. Jesus scoops up the nets from the sea, from this fear of danger and chaos, and he pulls a dragnet of fish into the boat, fish of all kinds. And in doing so, he tells us that God creates people to find sanctuary and salvation, no matter who we are or where we are in life. God loves us now, before we start making better decisions, before we wash ourselves clean. And by catching us up in his net, Jesus tells us that connection is the only thing that can save us. Connection to one another and connection to God. We are all in this thing called life together. We are not simply a bass or a trout or a salmon. We are fish. And we are God's. At the end of the day, God promises to catch us even at our worst. God promises to be there for us even when we feel weak or shameful about ourselves. God promises to be there even when we don't have the courage or strength to ask for help. God does not promise that we won't endure storms or whirlwinds. God does not promise that life will hurt us and sometimes may even break us. But God does promise to be there. God promises to be there and to help us rise, help us to make sense of our grief and our anger, and help us find new life and new joy. And as the chancel choir so beautifully sang this morning, God promises that there will be a balm in Gilead. This is what it means to be a disciple, to be committed to new life, even if it's painful, to welcome the stranger, to forgive others, to love our enemies, even when it's hard. This is the cross that we carry. And I think that God asks this of us because God knows how hard it is to live in this world. God knows that we live in a world where there is poverty and disease and war, homophobia and racism. But God also knows that we are God's and that there also exists an abundance a risk to open ourselves up to people. But it is also a joy. God promises to be bigger than all of our hurt. And that when we are part of community, we are part of something that is redemptive and is a blessing. It is a blessing to be here in sacred space. It is a blessing to find people who you can be with and be your full selves with. To be with a love that heals and mends all things. And I think that this is the message that Jesus was preaching that day on the lakeshore. Then I get it. I get why people decided to follow him, drop everything that they had, and were willing to travel with him wherever he lived. We're all in this boat together, hopefully going towards a destination of salvation. And of course, the journey is half the joy. Hopefully, we are working our way slowly towards healing, towards wholeness, towards a love that is more abundant than we can imagine. Like I said, I never expected to be a disciple, but I thank God that I got caught up in the net and pulled inside the boat. Will you pray with me this morning? Holy and abundant God, we offer thanksgiving and praise today for all the ways that you have picked us up, all the ways you have caught us up in your loving arms. Grant us courage and strength as we seek to be your people, welcoming one another despite our differences and failings. May we seek to follow you always, even imperfectly, on hard days and on days of rejoicing. Guide our steps towards the way of justice, the way of healing, the way of peace, and the way of life, now and forever. Amen.
I would invite all that are able now to please stand as we join together in hymn number 580, Jesus Leads Us or the Duo. Trust in the one who has called us to follow him, Jesus Christ. the strength of these gifts and strengthen our ministries, O God. Expand the nets of our love that we may reach deeply and share abundantly. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now let us join together in our closing hymn, page 648. O Jesus, I have promised. We go out into the mission field, unafraid.